Wow. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning, everybody. A hearty celebration welcome to everybody who is back in the sanctuary today, and also to all those folks who continue to be with us by the miracle of the internet. And we also extend a special welcome to those folks from Messiah Lutheran and Lyndhurst who are also tuning in as well. So we have a very wonderful representation of the church here in the sanctuary, and also as I said, out there in internet land. It's wonderful to see you all here, and just sort of FYI, you're all socially isolated or in your pods. Very well done. Everybody's wearing a mask. I'm not going to be wearing a mask during the time when I'm up here because I think I'm first off, I've had all my rabies shots, and secondarily, I'll be at least 10 or 20 feet from everybody, so I think that'll be relatively safe. A word about the service. I have on good authority from our resident musicologist, music teacher, and substitute musician for this morning, Beth, who informs me that the best and latest research as things have gone on is that transmission of virus when one is singing within a mask is no different than when one is speaking. Therefore, we're going to allow folks to sing, if you so desire. And for those of you who are liturgical, fans of liturgical correctness, you will notice that my stole is not white, which it should be, but white, I think, the light white encompasses every color, right, doesn't it? That's a scientific thing. And I thought, it's a festive day, I'm gonna wear my brightest and encompassing all the colors of the rainbow skull. So, you know, it's just good. It's just so strange to see everybody after having been here for 4 months and not having seen pretty much any of you, except at the food distribution and occasionally when somebody comes into the office and the folks who've been so faithfully engineering the broadcast. And so it's wonderful to see you all here. And again, thank you for continuing to wear your mask, continuing to be socially distant and all that. And I think we'll all get along very well. So, having gone through the introductory announcements, do I have any other announcements? I don't think before worship I have anything else. I'll have a few things after we with our normal announcements, but we will begin our worship together with our order for confession and forgiveness. You should all have your bulletins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I can't help it. Sounds so good. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the aid of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that, attentive to your word, we may confess our sins, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Friends, let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another.
Gracious God,
have mercy on us. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. Uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. We'll sing 1, 2, and 4 verses of Praise to the Lord.
Christ the Lamb.
God, you give us your Son as the vine, apart from whom we cannot live. Nourish our life in his resurrection, that we may bear the fruit of love and know the fullness of your joy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let's join together in a responsive reading from Psalm 22 as it is printed in your bulletins. From you comes my praise in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the sight of those who fear the Lord.
The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Let those who seek the Lord give you praise. May your hearts live forever.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of nations shall bow before God.
For the dominion belongs to the Lord, who rules over the nations.
Indeed, all who sleep in the earth shall bow down in worship. All who go down in the dust, though they be dead, shall kneel before the Lord.
Their descendants shall serve the Lord, whom they shall proclaim to generations to come.
And they shall proclaim God's deliverance to people yet unborn, saying to them, the Lord has acted. Our second reading is from 1 John chapter 4, beginning with the 7th verse. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this, we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and so testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God. They abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected. It's been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment. And whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, I love God, and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or a sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters. And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, my God.
beginning at the first verse.
Glory to you, Lord.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You've already been cleansed by the word I've spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Sometimes I have something to show for the children's service, sometimes I do not. I have this vine today, and it's already attacked my microphone. Now, if my wife were here, she would tell us what sort of plant this is. Did somebody mumble the name? I don't think so. I think it's something like that, but the leaves are very curly and strange. But anyway, it's a vine and it has many branches. It's been sitting on my kitchen counter for a while now to be transplanted outside at some point. But this is a nice picture. I didn't dig up my grapevine. Then you should all thank me for that, because I have to drag dirt and roots and everything in here. But it's kind of a nice illustration. Jesus says he's the vine and we're the branches, and the branches bear fruit. And I noticed today that there was little pods on the end of some of these branches, so they're starting to bear some fruit. Maybe that's going to be a flower. But the real purpose of this particular plant is just to look pretty. It really bears the fruit of beauty. And so sometimes when we think about who we are and what we do, sometimes when we think of Jesus as the vine and we're the branches of the vine, we think, well, what is the fruit that I'm supposed to bear? And I'm not even sure what fruit I'm supposed to bear, some of us might be saying. But this little plant here gives us an idea that the real thing we're supposed to bear is peace and love and beauty in the earth. Offering love to all those people around us, being a peaceful person, and just being like a beautiful light in the darkness that sometimes the world has in it. And so for the boys and girls out there that are listening, and you know, I hear from adults far and wide, the children's sermon meant a lot more to me than the real sermon. Here's Jesus, here's the representative of Jesus, the vine, and here we are as the branches, and some of us might be a little leaf right on the end of the branch, but we're all called by him to bear love and forgiveness and joy and peace and beauty, just like he has given first to us. Amen. Actually, now that I think of it, I might as well not give the other sermon. But sad for you all, I will. I It's hard to know where we are at with the ongoing pandemic. I was going to say it feels like we're kind of at the tail end of a very difficult time. But there's not really a guarantee that we are at the tail end of a difficult time with this virus that still is rampant in the world. We hear about other countries and other places, and travel is still very difficult and all those sorts of things. So we have been going through an exceedingly difficult time for our country, for the world, and of course, by extension, the church. And you know, I am an old dog of now something like 42 years in the ordained ministry, and I thought it would be nice to see you all here, and it's very nice, and I didn't expect that I would tear up over and over again to hear the voices and to see the faces, or at least the eyes. You know, like I said, for 4 months I've been the interim pastor of this congregation, and this is the first time I've seen a lot of you. And it's certainly the first time I've seen you all together in one bunch. But it's been an exceedingly difficult time to be sort of the dispersed and almost feeling like a church in exile or something from the building. But of course, the pandemic is not even the most trying things that beset the church or the most difficult times. We have been for some time now, seemingly, in a country that's very divided politically, and there's, you know, the liberals and the conservatives and the this and the that and all those sorts of things have made it to be a very difficult time to be in the United States. And we know that families certainly have been separated by the polarization that's gone on, and certainly friends have, and that sort of thing. And I recognize that there's a church that I go by on my way from my house to here, and from the messages that they have on their reader board, I know that I'm a very different kind of Christian than the pastor of that church, from the messages that he's putting out on the board in front of the church. And so there's all kinds of things. You know, people have asked me, and there have been a lot of fear, and there's been a lot of things. What will happen when we come back into in-person church? Will everybody come back? Well, let's see. I'm not a math man, so somebody else will have to count the rest, but it's a good bunch here. But how does the church survive difficult times like this? How does the church survive this pandemic and these crazy times when we hear of such violence that are going on in the country and in the world, and the sickness and all the things? It makes my head hurt just to talk about it. Oh, we're called back by our gospel reading today to the very basics. And it's the very basics that sustain the church and individual Christians through, dare I say, hell or high water, through the most difficult times in our lives. It's going back to the basics. It's going back to remembering that we indeed are branches of the true vine. That's a beautiful image, but it's more than a beautiful image, it's the truth. That we are made by, we're produced by, we're sustained by, and cleansed by Jesus Christ, who is our fount and source, the vine to us branches. we cannot be conformed to the world. And that's not just talking about liberals and conservatives and all that sort of thing. We cannot abandon our birthright as baptized children of God for some kind of general, generic, Americanized version of Christianity. The kind of thought, the kind of attitude that says, the Lord helps them that help themselves. That's in the Bible, you know. Anybody want to argue with me on that point? That ain't in the Bible, folks. Or, you know, look at me. I'm rich and I'm a self-made man. There's no one that's self-made in the sense that they did it all by themselves. There was help from others. I was thinking today, I read an article this week about Elon Musk, who is the CEO of Tesla and of SpaceX, and he's done a lot of crazy and amazing things with his companies. And the article I read said that he called a meeting of his managers of the SpaceX company at 1 a.m. on a Sunday night. Gives you an idea of how driven this man is. But he couldn't do the things that he did if it wasn't for a group of managers who would get up out of bed and go into the office, or maybe get out of bed and go out to a Zoom meeting or whatever it is at 1 a.m. because their boss said so. Nobody's self-made without the support of others. And most of all, we Christians are not made without our vine, Jesus Christ. So there's no room for standing on laurels or sitting on our haunches. We are called to remember. You know, it has maybe been easy kind of to sort of forget those words about, I am a baptized child of God. And it all starts in our lives with that moment and that change in status where we are forgiven sinners, where we are justified before God, where we are made right with God and with all creation, where we don't have to bear the stain of guilt or shame or all of the things that our past sins brings to us. Wiped clean, the slate is erased, and we are new. And we are His. Rooted to Him in baptism, tied to Him in faith, nourished, fed, sustained, cleansed by Him. And so, you know, for me, I don't know about anybody else in this room or anybody else, for me, when I hear those things that Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches, you have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you, I feel like I can exhale. And maybe in these months and months and months and months of being separate from the church building and separate one from another, maybe it's we've all been holding our breaths a little bit, and maybe hearing that Jesus has cleansed us and brought us together with God, we can let go of the breath we've been holding. Let our shoulders relax and sense the peace and calm of knowing that it was Jesus who claimed us, named us, and called us His own. And by feeling that peace, and by understanding that our source of nourishment is Jesus Himself, we also know that we're called to bear fruit. We We've heard that Jesus coming out of the grave is the first fruits of those who will rise again. And we are called to be fruitful, bear the fruit by following the words and actions of Christ. Regardless of what others may do, regardless of what others may say, regardless of the hubbub and ado that is happening in the world today, we're called to bear the fruit that Christ has given to us, that fruit of welcome to all, of forgiveness for all, of unlimited love for all. Those are things that have been given to each and every one of us. That's what Christ offers to us. And he calls us to follow him in offering that same welcome that he has given us. That same ability to give the peace that allows us to breathe out that breath we've been holding. It has been, you know, a question, I think, in folks' minds. You know, with the church council and those people that have been around here by onesies and twosies during this dispersed time, you know, how will the church do? How will Celebration Lutheran Church do? We're in an interim, we don't have a settled pastor. There's this wacky guy that's up there. We don't know anything about him. We can only hope we'll get rid of him soon and find something good. You know, what's going to happen to the church? What's going to happen to not just Celebration, but the Lutheran Church, the ELCA, and the Christian Church? Well, when we remember who we are, whose we are, when we remember our roots, and live as branches of the true vine, the church will thrive. It may be in different shapes, it may be in different sizes, but the gospel will not be silenced. Let us be loud and bold in proclaiming that gospel. Let us share the gifts that have been given to us. And let us trust in the future of the church and of each and every one of us. And we can trust in the future only for one reason and for one reason only. That we trust in God. Because the future is God's. And we are his. In his name. Sing our word song. Thank you. us be seated as we join together in a moment recognizing those folks who have answered a special call within our congregation. Council members. And I'm not sure who all's here and who's not, but Megan, Stephanie, Sally, and Daryl. If you're here, come on down. At least maybe stand on the green stripe here. Appropriately. Dear Christian friends, you're baptized into the priesthood of Christ, and as such, we are all called to offer ourselves to the Lord of the Church in thanksgiving for what he's done and continues to do for us. It's our privilege to recognize and support those who are engaged in the work of this congregation, especially those in the ministry of the Church Council. These people, having been elected, that's Megan, Stephanie, Sally, and Daryl, to the positions of leadership are here in front of us. And they are your representatives. In holy baptism, our Lord Christ liberated you from sin and death and made you members of this church. Through word and sacrament, you've been nurtured in faith. And so I ask you all to affirm your faith in Jesus Christ, the faith in which we are baptized. So let us all together say, we believe.
We believe.
Very good. St. Paul writes, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit gives them. There are different ways of service, but the same Lord is served. There are different abilities to perform service, but the same God gives to everyone ability for a particular service. The Spirit's presence is shown in some way in each person for the good of all. You folks have been elected to positions of leadership and trust in this congregation as church council members. You're to see that the words and deeds of this household of faith reflect God in whose name we gather. You're to work together with other members to see that the worship and work of Christ are done in this congregation, and that God's will is done in this community and in the whole world. It's a big order. You're to be diligent in your area of serving, that the one Lord who empowers you is glorified. You're to be examples of faith, active in love, to help maintain the life and harmony of this congregation. On behalf of your sisters and brothers in Christ, I ask you, are you ready to accept and to faithfully do these duties to the office to which you have been elected? If so, please answer together, yes, by the help of God.
Yes, by the help of God.
People of God, that's all y'all. I ask you, will you support these, your elected leaders, and will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all who are baptized? If so, please together answer yes by the help of God.
Yes, by the help of God.
Sounded good. I now declare you four installed as officers and council members of this congregation. God bless you with the Holy Spirit, that you might prove faithful servants of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We pray. For all who offer themselves in your name, we give thanks, O God. Give them the joy of service and constant care and guidance. Help us all to be both willing servants and thankful recipients of ministry, that your name be glorified, your people live in peace, and your will be done through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Turn around and face the congregation. Yes, promise to show them your support.
Okay,
alive and risen Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. God of all fruitfulness, you abide in your church, and your church abides in you. Cleanse us by your word, and give yourself to the whole church on earth, so it bears fruit and witness to your love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You have created the heavens and the earth. As we wonder at the beauty of creation, may we seek vital connections among all that depends on the earth for life. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You rule the nations with justice and love. Give the leaders of the earth assistance of your abiding presence, that they lead not by fear, but with love for those they are called to serve. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You have loved us so that we can love others. We pray for all those in need of your love, those who are poor, lowly, outcast, weak, or fearful. Provide for the needs of all, especially those we name now, silently or aloud. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We give thanks that after all the many months of separation from each other, that we are now able to worship in person. We also are grateful for the work of scientists, production, and logistics workers, and the shopkeepers, that we may move on from this pandemic. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You gather us with all the saints by the power of your Spirit. With them, may our hearts live forever in your keeping. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
priesthood at all times and in all places, give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending praise. Thank you. body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Strengthen us and keep us in his grace.
Amen.
It is the second day of May, and we are rather quickly, it seems, marching through the church year. So along with the newsy, there is the opportunity to purchase geraniums to decorate our sanctuary for Pentecost Sunday, which is the 23rd of May, so that's only, my count, 21 days away. That's about almost 3 weeks, isn't it? There's the opportunity still on Saturday, May 22nd, to join in the workday for sprucing up the gardens and landscaping around.
Also
this Wednesday, that's right. Wednesday the 5th. I already had the 5th gone in my mind. Anyway, Wednesday the 5th, Saturday the 22nd. The book study continues, dear church, Tuesdays at 10 here in the church, and also by Zoom. Let Paul know if you have an interest in that. You're doing a great job of staying in your little pods or family groupings. Very good. Keeping masks on, also very good. We'll be doing that continually. Now that we are all kind of back together, and hopefully will remain such, it has been a faithful remnant doing worship assisting and reading. And all y'all are invited to be a worship assistant in leading the prayers, and we can assist you with drafting those prayers or giving you prayers to read, and also reading the scriptures for the appointed Sundays. Please consider yourself invited, encouraged. Don't make me twist your arm. Or even worse, make Neil twist your arm, which is even worse. Wednesday worship continues at 7 p.m. and it will be what? In person and on Facebook Live. So that will be particularly enjoyable as well. And I encourage you to attend either virtually or in person. I think that and later on in the month of June, we have a polka worship coming up. That will be a lot of fun. That, I believe, we'll see how that all fits together. That might be outside, might be in here, whatever, but that will be coming up. And I think there's going to be some snacks. Am I right, Paul? Paul's
yeah. We have lunch for
a brunch. There'll be a brunch, sort of.
So,
there'll be food of some type of description that will fit. Yes, Neil.
I'll just come up and say this. So
very good.
Be too hard to yell. Just wanted everybody to know that Pastor Laura Barbins, our new bishop, is being installed on June 12th in Akron, Ohio, at the Knight Center. Celebration has been given 30 seats for people to attend the service live. There was a note in the, there was a blast that went out to everybody, but if you want to attend, please email Gail Goldsworth at ggoldsworth@oh.rr.com or see her this morning. So we've got some people signed up already. It's on a first come, first served basis. Thank you, sir.
Very well done. Anything else? Okay. Well, as we begin to end our time together, I'll remind you also we're not going to be gathering in the gathering space for fellowship or greeting one another, but I invite you to run outside and say hi to folks as you wish in the fresh air. But in the meantime, receive the blessing of the Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face smile on you, and may the Lord be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with kindness and with favor, and may the Lord grant you peace. Amen. We will sing our Sunday song.
Guided by the light of Christ.